All right, hello everyone, this is Kevin Kitchens again with Once Upon a Game, and today we're going to look at the Conflict of Heroes, Awakening the Bear, Firefight Generator. This is for generating two-player conflicts, solo conflicts, and on up to three- and four-player conflicts based on the various scenario templates that are defined. So what you get in the game is... And the expansion, I should say, is a deck of generator cards for each side. The Soviets and the Germans. A set of condition cards that'll alter the effects on the board. You will get these record boards for the Soviets and the Germans, and instructions, as well as, where is it? The mission sheet for solo, and the mission sheet for defense, and that's when you're going solo. But this is again also available as, you know, to develop multiplayer games. So essentially what it is kind of a game before the game, as each player tries to outmaneuver the other in defining the mission itself, trying to get the best, play the best cards to their benefit, to set the mission up to their benefit, and to play cards that maybe hinder their opponent. So it's kind of like a little mini chess game before, and then, you know, you set it up and you play. And then when you're doing solo, you take it a few steps further and make some decisions and set up your mission tracker based on the outcome. You are motivated to build each side as evenly as possible because you're going to do a die roll after you set each side up to determine which side you get to play. So it's kind of like a, you know, like if you used to do with your siblings, I'll cut it and you pick kind of thing, except you're doing it with yourself. And then the AI, there's a few adjustments to the game to compensate for the AI taking over. A few changes, a few card differences, things like that. But it's really an awesome system. One thing that's actually kind of cool is you get this stack of 25 chits for the mission card based on the cards that get chosen. And what's really neat is that they set them up, you can see here, so that they fit in this slot in the base game box already. So they go right there. So that's pretty cool. All right, so we're just going to start at the top here, try to do this real quick, just kind of give an overview of how this works. So to create the solo mission, you start out basically by just building a two-player mission. So after you go through the very brief rule set and instructions for setting up a firefight, you've got these templates on the back pages that give you the guidelines for how to set up the firefight. I call it a template because it kind of just dictates the structure in which it plays. It tells you roughly how long the game will last. You know, the players, how many rounds the game should play. Which, you know, human versus human is going to be one thing, but that actually corresponds to a number on the mission tracker as well, to let you know when the mission should end. So, if you've seen my previous video, I'm waiting on the corrected Russian cards. So there was a firefight here that I can create using the cards that I do have. It's a light armor firefight. It's played by one German, one Soviet. Plays for 5 rounds. Should last 45 minutes. One thing to note here is I discovered the action cards. These are the ones that are in the base game. This says to include all action and bonus cards numbered 2 through 13 and number 20. And that's great if you're playing a human opponent, but there are some cards that are going to have to come out playing the AI because they just don't make any sense. One is, for example, number 13, sniper fire. You reduce caps for your opponent. They don't have caps. The other is experienced sergeant. I ran into this one. And you added a D6 to your activated unit's AP track. Well, you don't use an AP track. You use the card flip to see if your unit is spent or not. So There may be some more in there. I didn't go through them all. I just, as I drew mine for the turn, I said, oh, this doesn't apply, and I discarded it and drew another one. So something to consider. You could maybe make a variant of those, do something. I don't know. I just chose to leave them out. There weren't specific instructions on that. So the first step, so I've got set up over here the Soviets. I've got set up here the Germans. The first thing is you would roll a die for initiative. And so I would just say 1 through 3, 4, 5, 6. And that's the standard way of doing it. It's 1. So the Soviet player gets the initiative on everything. Soviet player would pick a map. He's already picked this one, because that's the one I had out, and that's it's just as fine to use that. So that's one thing initiative gets you, is you get to pick the map. Then the initiative player also chooses the map edge the units will enter from, just for ease. I could have turned the map around, but we'll have the Soviets entering from this side, the Germans entering from this side. There's a variant where the non-initiative player can add a second map, so you can make it a bigger firefight, but we're not going to do that in this case because it already kind of takes up a lot of space. It's one thing about this is these cards, I originally envisioned this as being something where you would set up the firefight and end up with, you know, kind of a guideline and maybe transcribe everything into a quick little neat package that you played from, just like the firefights in the books are. But really, these cards stay in play because you got variable victory conditions, things like that. So it does take up a little bit of extra space. They do show a suggested game layout here. I'll try to put that up there where you can see it, where you got players on one side or the other, and then the boards stay on the play, and then the two-player cards, you know, sit out there. But I'm not doing that for solo, so I'll show you that in a minute. Hopefully, we get that far. Okay, so then it also tells you which cards you're going to use of the generation decks for each side, and they're the same. And everyone I've seen, they're always the same set because each one's numbered differently. So in this case, the Germans and the Soviets used from their deck cards 10 through 16. They're going to start out with 4 caps, which I'm going to register up here on the solo track sheet. I just put where the caps are starting for each side. And that'll switch in a minute because obviously the AI is not going to get any caps when the game starts. How many action cards they get when the game begins, and the hand size for the generator deck to be used. How this works in solo, normally what you would do with two players is you've got these two decks, 7 cards each. Give them a quick shuffle. And so you would normally then just deal 5 cards. Each side would take their top 5 cards, and they would work from that hand, playing cards for different effects. To build up their squads, things like that. How you do that similarly here, to keep it kind of a secret, I'll show you right now as we get started. So those are both shuffled. We also have some condition cards here that we'll shuffle. Sometimes you pick them, sometimes you shuffle them, but we'll go ahead and just get those shuffled, put those up here. So what's going to happen is the Soviet player goes first, and so he's going to draw 2 cards, top 2. And each card has, try to focus here. Am I making it worse? I don't know. Let's see if I get to focus, sorry. Focus. Pardon the focus noise here, it's gonna zap us a bit, I think. Okay. There's 2 parts to each card, okay? In the case of card 15, you have a special event, and you have forces. You have victory points, you have forces. You're going to play one of these cards for 1/2. So you choose, do I want the forces, or do I want the conditions? You're only going to play 5 cards, so you want to get as many forces on as you can. But if you don't give yourself any victory conditions, you got nothing to shoot for. And remember, at this time, you don't know which side you're going to be playing. So a lot of different options here. So This one says special event, draw two condition cards. So you would draw the two condition cards. You'd play one for the top and one for the bottom, and that would put those conditions in play. And then it says three Soviet units may set up within 5 hexes of the Soviet entry edge, which would be over here. However, when you play this for this event, you don't have any units yet. So if you at the time you play this, you better have units or you don't get that benefit. It happens when you play it. So that would be a clue to maybe hold off this one unless you just wanted those units and never wanted to use that. You also get a +1 on the command points. How that comes into play is as you're building up your command points, like you started with 4, like I said, you can add to them and you'll start out with 6 for each round. However, if the Soviet side ends up being the AI, then what will happen is those command points above and beyond the 4 that it started with for this scenario get translated to additional cards into the AI deck. So they thought pretty much of everything. It's a pretty awesome old system. So the other one for victory points, the Soviets get 2 victory points if at the end of the firefight they get 2 victory points for each Soviet unit that is closer to the German entry edge than the Soviet entry edge. So they're going to be working their way across, and if they just end up over here, they're going to rack up 2 victory points. If they can get up here and camp, that's something pretty cool. So, and there, you'll see it later, but there's actually special orders that direct them to try for that. So because if this card goes into play as a victory point marker and the Soviets do become the AI, they're going to try for that. So it's really a well thought out system. So I think I'm going to go for that one. We'll put that down. So what you do here is it's a victory point marker. So you're supposed to slide it under the board there so it shows that the victory points are up. Then you take the card you didn't use, put it back on top. So that'll be one of your cards for the next turn. So you don't lose it. You know it's one of your cards, but you don't know what the second card is going to be. So this goes back and forth. German's going to take 2 cards. So they've got victory points for reconnaissance, and they've got special event in position. They can place 1 card's units anywhere on the map. So when they play this, if they've claimed a card for units, then they can take all those units will start off board, but because of this special condition, they're allowed to put them anywhere on the map, not just on their edge. So that's a perk they may want. And then this, so like if we take this card here, we have a half track and a anti-tank flat gun, and you get extra command points, and you get to place a random defense counter when you take this. So you know, lots of choices. They also have a reconnaissance option. The German chooses a Soviet unit as a recon target. So you don't want to play this till there's a Soviet unit around. You mark that Soviet unit. What I did is I put a little die on it. And at the end of any round, if you have it in line of sight, you get 2 victory points. So whereas the other one is 2 victory points for the Soviets for each unit, you know, it's across the middle of the board, this is every round 2 victory points as long as you can just see that unit. So just keeping some small troop where you can see it. So lots of cool little options here, and with the full 25 card deck, and there's some scenarios that actually use the full 25 card deck, you're going to get a lot of choices and a lot of tug of war. For example, Guideline 5 uses all 25 cards, but there's only 5 of them that get used. I mean, it's 25 to choose from, so it's, you know, regular shuffle and draw the cards. So, I am going to, for the Germans, I'll take the victory points again. Just want to get some of those in play. So, card goes back on top, and we go back and forth. Take 2 more cards. So we're going to try to get some units on here. There's a special event here for choose terrain that you can replace the map with another map, which in this case the Soviets picked the map, so why would they want to change it unless something else changed? Any units that were on the board come back on board in the same hexes, so I would guess that you'd want to make sure you oriented it the same way, because you could maybe shift them around. But I guess if the German had already placed units way over here or something and you put a new map out, you could flip, turn the tables on them literally, bring the map around, and they'd be back over here, and that would be their side again. So, and there's an option right before the game starts to adjust your all your facing. So, we're gonna get some tanks in here. Last time I did this scenario, I didn't get enough units on the board, so we're gonna skip the condition guard thing, and we are going to go with we get unit 43 and 44, which is two T26s. And go to my box here. It's very helpful to keep your units in order. 43 and 44. So there's 43. 44. And again, they're just going to set up off board. These guys aren't in play. These are just ones I know that might come up. So they're off board for now until we do something to put them into play. So I'm going to stop right here, and we're going to come over to the German cards in just a second. All right, we're going to draw up two German cards now. And we've got the same one, the in position, where you can place them anywhere on the map. They have no units, so we can't play that. Also, choose terrain. They're able to flip the terrain around if they want to, which we don't want to. So we'll play this one for units. And in this case, we get number 44, 25, and we get a bonus cap. So I'm going to take the German cap marker, move it up to 5. That means I'll start with 5. And going to go through my units and get 44 and 25, which is a tank hunter and a panzer jag. I'm not really up on all these abbreviations, so they come in and they're off board ready to be used next time. So we slide those under the unit cards. Alright, back to the Soviets. Alright, we're not going to choose terrain. Misinformation: the German cards units enter on round 2 as reinforcements from any map edge that the German declares after setup is complete. Place the chosen cards units on the 2 space of the player's firefight round track. Which we don't have a round tracker in the solo game, so that'll happen later, but essentially it takes them out of the game for round 1 if they want to play that. However, we may have to, because this is one thing that was kind of weird. The last time I played the scenario, I got the wagon, and the wagon has no special purpose. I guess he could be used to try to just get across board, and that would count. That gives him some kind of value, but for the most part, well, he actually did take a victory location, a control marker, and sat on it for a while because nobody could actually hit him for some reason. So, it just seemed kind of strange, but he eventually got taken out. So we'll go ahead and play that for units. Because we don't want to change terrain. No, I'm going to change my mind. We're going to play this one because this one gives me a truck. And a truck gets the bonus wheeled movement if he can stay on the road. So therefore he will get a chance to get across faster. And if he can duck into some cover or something, he'd be good. So, and this shows us the random defense counters scenario too. So I need, 29, 36, and plus 1 cap. So now Soviets move up on the cap, and we're going to take 29, which is an anti-tank gun, and 36, which is the truck. There he is, and they're going to go off board, and then we also get to place 2 random defense counters. So how that works is you got all your defense counters from the game in a bowl. You got mines, you got everything. So what I do is I just randomly pick one, and then without looking at it, I roll a die. 1 to 3 is front. Yep. So the front of this one, got a trench. So the Soviet gets to place a trench, and this was played for units. So we slide that under the units. Oh, and I get 2 of these actually, so draw another one. And we'll go ahead and roll again. And also front, and we got a hasty defense marker. Alright, so we'll just put this somewhere. The one thing about this is you've got a trench. It'll block movement, and the Soviets want to get across. I don't know. Before the game's set up, it's kind of hard to determine where you want to move, so we'll just place it right here, make them go down the road, maybe be in the open, and then the hasty defense. There's not really a lot of infantry in this game, so only in this scenario, there's a lot of vehicles, so yeah, we'll see if it does any good. So you notice he's already got one victory point, he's got two for units, so he's probably about done on units. So you might, you know, there's four counters here. You might play one for a special rule in event and one more for units, but we'll see. Just depends on what cards you get. So the Germans draw, they get a couple of Panzer, they got a Panzer III, a Panzer IV. They can take a Panzer II, a pair of Panzer IIs. These are designed so that each marker only shows up on one card of the 25, so you can never duplicate. You can never worry about that. Victory points for kill count. Choose a German unit to become elite. German, plus 3 victory points. Immediately receive plus victory points for each Soviet the chosen elite unit destroys. So that is pretty awesome. The downside is you've got to have a unit already. And right now, all he's got is the Tank Hunter and the Panzer Jag, and I don't know that we want to do those. So I think what we're going to do is, we've already got a victory point indicator. I think he's going to play it for get the two Panzers, because they've got a 3 and a 5, and a 5 and a 3. Oh, they're pretty well balanced, and their range is shorter. But they got a better armor. So they want to survive longer. So we'll take the one of the two Panzers for units, put the other card back. And so it's designated as 49 and 54. Put it under. And you draw 49 and 54. 49. 54. Definitely good to keep the units in numerical order in your box. So as of right now, we've not set any units up on the board. We've not played any special rules and events to allow us to set units up on the board. So then what will happen is, as this is the Soviet side and this is the German side, your first turn will be moving units onto the board. So this will be the fourth card for the Soviets. Try to move a little faster here. We definitely want to get one special rule if we can. We're going to go ahead and play this one for victory points. Capture. Place a German control marker at least 6 hexes from the Soviet entry hedge, and at the end of each round, receive a victory point for each Soviet control marker. So we'll start out as German, and you bring it in so it can be at least 6 inches from the Soviet entry side. 6 hexes. So you want to put it somewhere where possibly you can capture it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Maybe without protection. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 on the road. And we'll put it on the crossroads because that might be a pretty important spot. It has to be at least six hexes in, which it is. So put that up under victory points. So he's got 4 cards in play. He's only going to get one more now. And then Germans come up. And they've again only got, they've got 3 and 1 defensive with the tank. They go victory points. Soviet chooses a Soviet target unit. They must destroy at any cost. Soviet places the chosen unit anywhere on the map. So this is where I could pick one of those units that's over there, and then the Soviet player immediately has to put them on the map. And then I could play a card that lets me put units on the map, especially if I had the one here that lets me place units anywhere on the map. And I could put them right next to him and try to kill him like immediately for 4 victory points. So that's pretty awesome. Let's see, we got some guns, and then we got the 2 Panzer IIs. I think we're going to forego the place cards units anywhere on the map. We'll go ahead and take those 2 Panzer IIs and the +1 cap. So the Germans go up 1 cap, And units 45 and 46 come on the field. Looks like I already had those. Previous game, yeah, there's 45 and 46. All right, so the Germans now have six units. See, here's where the outsmarting goes. The Germans have used three cards for units, one card for victory points. The Soviets have used two cards and two cards for victory points. So the Soviets' card is their last card. So what are they going to do? First of all, they're going to look at all the cards. So they take two, and they're going to play one. These are both special events. The misinformation and the expanded front is place a second map, and then place any number of Soviet units on the map, place a Soviet control marker, and the length of the firefight is extended by one round. So this would go into a six-round firefight, which doesn't really affect the solo play. So we're fine. We're going to go with the units, and we're just not going to have a special event for the Soviets this game. So those two cards are discarded, and he's going to get a T-26 and a T-35, 42 and 47. I don't know if I had those yet or not. I did not. So we're going to pull out. That was a German. So we pulled out 42. And 47. Obviously, a lot of this is going to go a lot further and a lot faster when you're setting up your own games, because you're not sitting here trying to explain it all. So 42 and 47. So now I feel like I've got a decent, we've each got six counters that are going to go on the board. But we'll see what the Germans do. Germans get the destroy set out of the target. They also get exposed for victory points. Soviet player chooses a unit, places it anywhere on the map. In addition, the Soviet places a cards unit anywhere on the map. The German then chooses a new entry edge. And in the that allows the Soviet player to hide a unit. And so that's good there. But what we're going to do is play the... Since we don't want... We want more units or more victory points. We will... we'll take that destroy marker for victory points. So the Germans have played all their cards. Alright, so we get to destroy a Soviet target unit. So we're going to look at the different target units here and see which one probably has the worst armor. We're going to take that truck. We're going to take out that truck is what we want to do. So the Soviet places the chosen unit anywhere on the map. Now the Soviet unit wants to put him way back here. Where he's safe. So he's on, and the Germans will get four victory points immediately for destroying the Soviet target unit. So I'm going to put this little red die on him that he's marked, and he's the one that they're going to try to hit. So the five cards are done. We've got the units. At this point, no cards units are going in, so we can just stack them all up here, up our board, and they're here ready to go on the board, and they're ready to go on the board. Now, the next thing you do is you look at all the cards that were played for victory points or special rules, and you take those numbers, in this case, 11, 13, 11, and 10. So 10, 11, and 13. And what you will do is you will take the tiles, 11, 13, and 10. And here's where you get to roll the dice and determine which side you get. Make sure I don't skip any steps. Yep. So, 1 to 3 is Germans, 4 to 6 Soviets is the AI. No. You're rolling to see which side the player plays. 1 to 3 is Germans, 4 to 6 Soviets. 3, player is the Germans, 4, the AI is going to be the Soviets. So now you take these tiles, and if you see in the corner here, they each have axis marker or the Soviet marker. So you're going to flip them all to the Soviet side. They also have a marker here for offense or a shield for defense. These all have offense. So what you would normally do is you would count these up. You could have up to, you know, you could have up to 10 in theory if nobody played for units, but then the game would be over. So you take these and you count up the number of offenses versus the number of defenses. So it's 3 versus 0, so there's more offensive. So that tells you that when you set up the solo mission sheet, you're going to set it up on the offensive side versus the defensive side. And they're going to have different actions that happen on that. So we're going to set that up in just a second. Okay, so now we're about to set up the offensive solo mission sheet. So what you do is we've got all these flipped over. You've got red, pink are your counteractions. You've got your green, which are your mission orders. And then you've got your, we've got another pink, which is another counteraction. So what you're going to do is you're going to place these in numerical order in the spots provided. So 10 will go before 13. And that's the order that they're going to get taken in. In the solo overview, you probably saw where solo missions actually have defined counteractions that get used in the game, depending on how the card works. Let me, where's my cards? There. So when you play a card, you're going to work your way down, and the first step is execute counteractions, and then you may get to one where it says execute mission orders, which are orders specific to the mission. The mission track, had we used one of the cards for the mission track, let's say this one had been in play, right? It would have gone in play at tile 1A, where it says tile 1A, because your marker is going to start here. And then this would go here, and you would move to it. And if you hit it, you would do what this mission track card says, and then you would take it and move it to 1B, 1C, 1D, 1E, so you could hit it several times throughout the mission. So it definitely a lot of variability, because it's all going to hinge on what cards you played. Each card is associated with an activity to benefit the victory points that were specified or the special rules and events. I think most special rules and events probably happen down here, whereas most of the victory point cards are here. So, for example, on 13, card 13 for the Soviets, which was trying to figure out where I did with it there. If card 13 is in play, it is. I got my Soviet and Axis split up. Sorry, I could edit that, but I'm not going to. The goal is to forward assault to get across the line, so the Soviets want to get at least halfway across. When they do their counteractions, they'll try this counteraction first, which says that there's more fresh AI than fresh units, which means the AI has more fresh units. Then the AI closest to a unit will move towards. The second counteraction, if an AI is closer to the Soviet entry edge than the German entry edge, then he tries to move farther. The unhit AI that is farthest from a fresh unit or control marker will try to move towards the German edge. So they're actively going to try, because that was a victory point and that got assigned to the AI. They're going to try to do and accomplish that goal for that victory point. Also, an AI that's closest to a German control marker, because card 11 got played. The German control marker got played in here. They get points for taking over that German control marker. So they get to mission orders. They're going to try to flip that control marker. It's very well done. It's very well thought out. In fact, I didn't realize till the end of the last game that I was actually playing this wrong. I couldn't figure out. I thought the edge victory point goal wasn't working because I misread this as they were already closer to the German edge, not closer to their own. And I just stopped the game because, I mean, there were several times this could have been played and the Soviets would have been across the line many, many, many times. Instead, I left them up here in firefights and they got pretty slaughtered, although they were holding their own there at the end. Man, it's a great narrative. Soviets become the became the AI, so their command points go away. They did get one extra one, one extra command point, so that means they will start out, none of these went into play, so that means they will start out with one extra card in the order deck from the solo system. One rule that it gives you is it tells you if you're building defensive side, you use the cards 5 through 43. If you're using the offensive side, you use the cards 13 through 51. For each cap the AI received from playing top and bottom generator cards, they get an additional card. So if it's offense, you'll use the highest numbered order card that's not already in the deck. So there's 55 cards, and they start on defense and end in offense, so you would actually bring in number 55 and then 54 or 53, and you'd work them in. There are some of these counteractions chits that say if the command order cards of the type being used or not, you randomly choose one of the missing ones and shuffle it into the deck. There's another one that was in play last game that the chosen AI executes all moves as low risk. Low risk is a defined move type for the AI in the solo game, which basically means they want to improve their defensive position. If they're already in line of fire, they can move to a better line of fire spot, or they can move out of line of fire. There's a process that you walk through. It's really easy. It's just basically, you know, preserve the unit. They can move closer if they don't give up their cover. If they can improve their cover, they can move closer. They can keep their distance the same. I think we talked about in the overview video. They also can they can just pivot. If there's a unit adjacent to them, then their move counts as a pivot to face that unit, so they're not, you know, caught from behind. So make sure I'm not forgetting any steps. Basically, you run through the mission track, the in-game marker, because this scenario template defined it as 5. You just put a marker on there. I just use this time counter from the base game. Throw it on there as the end. When the AI has units moving onto the board here, you're going to put them into a draw cup. So if something on board cannot move, you're going to draw one and put them in, bring them into play on their entrance edge. And you draw them and try to move. If for some reason that unit cannot move onto the board, then you're going to put them back in the draw cup and pass. And so they'll still be active for later. There are some rules about certain cards, and there are some rules to make the game a little harder. You can give the reduce your caps on the game. You can do add additional command cards to the AI deck. Lots of different things you can add to it. But I found it to be very challenging, very fun. I had the Soviet AI down to 2 units and couldn't finish the job. Because one thing that always happens is you can keep drawing command cards for the AI, and they can keep acting even though they're they're all spent. Because unless you choose to pass before you've used all your units. But if you use your unit, then he gets to draw again, and he may get a command card, and he may get to shoot. And when you got these guys with turrets, you know, they can take a shot at you. And it's a command card, so they're not going to take any not going to use up any action points. So they're not going to go spent just because they, you know, shot around the turret. Because it's like using caps. So that's the way the system works. You can do what you want. Like, you can do a move, you know, one action point with the unit and not get spent. And then you can, you know, pull out a 7 to hide or a 5 to rally or something like that. Essentially you've used lots of action points without using any of your caps. Same works for the AI. They get all these bonuses too. So there's some special notes in here about rumored enemies, artillery strikes. Some cards apparently will give you an artillery strike before the game starts, and then you will, there's rules to mitigate that. The different chits that come on the mission sheet will take care of that for the solo. Again, I cannot say this enough. This is a well thought out system. Sure, there may be some typos. There's been, you know, 1 or 2, but really, it's not been a hassle at all. It's been very easy to play. you know, you can, you know, if you have a place set up where you can just leave it, you can stop and come back to it at any time. You can pull a couple of cards, do a couple of moves, come right back to it. The AI doesn't cheat. He doesn't try to move your units around. It's been really fun, and I want to thank Academy for giving me a chance to take a look at this and share it with you. I know it's shipping USA on the 12th of August, and then Canada on the 19th, and Europe on the 26th of August. So you will all have it very soon. I know I ramble a lot. I'm not really scripted here, obviously. One thing you do that I didn't show is when you're done, you have these, you're going to need these in play, your victory point indicators. And what I usually do is I just leave them stacked on each side. I try to clean up some of this because I don't really need this anymore. I'll keep the unit cards available if I need it, because sometimes these will refer to something with the units of a card. So you may have to do something with that. But then basically the victory points will just stay on the side of the board. There's some cool condition cards we didn't get into because we didn't play anything for condition. Add snow or mud. You can play it for the top or the bottom. And the player that drew this card, because you're randomly picking a condition card, you can place the card's units anywhere on the map. Players do not receive the default one victory point for destroying enemy units. So that condition's in play for the game. So victory points are only earned by hitting victory conditions that came up in the generator, not through the normal rules of play. Player that drew this card can draw two Firefight Generation cards from the opponent's deck and choose one and play the top option for yourself. And all references to German or Soviet are switched. So you're taking one of their cards, playing it for yourself. That's pretty awesome because it takes it out of their ability. Especially if it's the card he just put back. Well, he wouldn't have done that in a two-player game. You would draw two, so you'd know, you know, when you're building an AI game, you're already going to know what one card is, so I don't know how you'd work around that. You can add fog or dust. You got night, so line of sight is equal to the number of hexes on a d6, and at the beginning of each round, the night conditions change as the moon goes in and out of the clouds. So lots of really cool things. This is the one I had last game. Freezing cold. Any rally attempts had a -1 die roll penalty. Made it even harder to rally. So definitely a lot of variability. There's only six of these cards, I believe. Actually, there may be a few more. Let's look in the box. But, you know, there's not many of the condition cards, but the way they come in is not very often. But when you use them, you know, they can totally change the whole game. Tons of replayability on here. This will make, I will say that down the road, hopefully this will be an app. This would be awesome to set up, to even do the game, you know, the card, especially for solo, is to be able to build the scenario solo and then have it develop a mission sheet for you. The same as the solo missions are done, where it just takes these, automatically puts them on, you know, adjusts these when they're needed. Because even though you're moving the tile, it could just reprint that kind of information into those tile slots, so on and so forth. They're assuming you're only going to have like two of the mission tiles in play. That would be a neat option down the road. I don't know how that would work. I mean, you know, it'd like kill sales of the card version, but definitely awesome for a two-player game, setting up multiplayer firefights. The biggest one they've got in here is for four players. They got a three-player and a four-player, two Germans versus one Soviet, and two Germans versus two Soviets, and it's for four players, and they each build their side up. They all get their caps and do everything, so that's just pretty awesome. Lots of good, like I said, templates, and then you just go from there. So anyway, I will sign off now because, again, I'm rambling, but I hope you've enjoyed this. Again, enjoy it when you get it yourself. And talk to you soon. Happy gaming.